I was reading over it again, and I'm like, man, how did this just not jump off the page before? And the Lord was reminding me, well, these things aren't going to jump off the page until I make them jump off the page. And so this is one of those passages that is kind of tucked in there. And I just thought it was interesting, the terminology, when you read this. Proverbs chapter 6, it'll begin in verse 19 or 16, and we'll read down to the 19th verse. Stand with me tonight for the reading of the word of the Lord. And we will do our best to minister to you tonight. Tonight, probably, I'll warn you. Did this morning minister to you?
Yes.
Amen. Let me tell you real quick. The young lady that had the issues went to the hospital. She was conscious talking. Doctors a moment ago, her husband said that they can't find anything in her tests or anything like that. As soon as they get her headache down, she's going home. So praise God. But here's the thing with that. As soon as she left the building, the microphone went crazy.
Yeah.
All right? I was resting. With everything in me, I wanted to stop. Yeah. Just go over and, you know, tend to the need. You could probably see that. Well, no, you couldn't, because all of y'all were doing this. So I was.
We know.
So anyways, most of them were. Hallelujah. So I was internally, I was back. You know, Lord, do I, you know, I mean, we're not prepared. They don't teach that in a book, you know. And I felt the Lord at that moment say, keep preaching.
Yeah.
You've got to finish this.
Yes.
And because we were only two out of three. We were neighbors and brothers. We didn't get to enemy yet. Yeah. And our enemy was doing something.
Yes. Yes.
As soon as she left, the microphone starts breaking down.
Yeah.
And it was during the enemy part. I get done and people start coming up to me at the altars, tears rolling down their face. I needed to hear the last part of that message, and I'm so glad you preached it. So praise God.
Amen.
We got through
yeah.
what God wanted us to do.
Amen.
I don't care what the devil tries. As long as there's breath in my lungs, if y'all have to push me up on here on the stage, I'm going to preach this word.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Yeah.
Proverbs chapter 6, beginning in verse 16. These six things doth the Lord hate. Look at that. I didn't make that up. It specifically says God hates these things. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. I'm going to deal with that in a moment as well. Here's the seven things. Listen to this. Verse 17, a proud look. We're going to talk about all these tonight. A lying tongue. Hands that shed innocent blood. A heart that devises wicked imaginations. Feet that be swift in running to mischief or sin. A false witness that speaketh lies. Well, isn't that the same as a lying tongue?
Yes.
Well, it is, but we'll discuss it in just a moment. And he, listen to this, seven things God hates. Look at the last one. He that soweth discord among the brethren.
Yes.
You're not going to shout me down tonight. In fact, I hope you wore your steel toes, your shin guards, whatever it is you need, however deep it's going to get for you. Because this is one of those sermons where the Holy Spirit, through Solomon, just brings out the whooping stick. Understand tonight that when God says he hates something, he's not talking about a lost person. When God hates something, it's because it's came into a believer's life. Someone that's been redeemed. Somebody that has known the power of what it is to escape what Peter said, the pollution of the world through the knowledge of Jesus Christ, and then they're entangled again therein and overcome. This is what we're dealing with tonight, and I'm not saying that you're in this place, but I believe tonight what God's pointing out, seven things that he hates are, listen to this, seven things that can potentially come back and overcome you as a believer.
Yeah.
And so we got to be careful. That's what?
Wow.
So tonight's one of those messages that's going to edify you, because you're going to get a deeper look into things that can potentially come back. Things that may have already attacked in our church or in people's lives.
Yes.
Things that may be happening in your own families or your friends.
Yes.
But things, nonetheless, that we can protect and guard ourselves against our adversary.
Amen.
And against our humanity, our sin nature. So seven things that God hates. Father, we ask you now, anoint me.
Yes, Jesus.
I need your spirit, Lord, to touch me tonight. You put this on my heart for probably a month and a half, but Lord, tonight's the night that you want to deliver. We didn't even get to this last week. But God, here we are, and I ask you now to use me, minister. Those hearing by whatever form they hear, video, online, whatever it may be tonight, Lord, I'm asking that you would put these in their hearts as well. And God, at the end of this, we would be encouraged Encouraged in the fact that you would reveal these downfalls to us before they would ever happen. Edified in the fact that your Spirit, thousands of years ago, would protect the hearts of people today by showing us things that you dislike and disapprove of. And so, Lord, help us tonight to guard ourselves. Equip us with your word tonight. Let us continue to study these things and move forward in the knowledge of your gospel. We thank you for it, and we ask it in Jesus' name. You can be seated tonight. Seven things God hates. This is a subject that I thought you probably think you'd never hear at church, because that word hate is such a strong word, especially when it's connected to God. Seven things that God hates. You know, the world tries to paint him as an angry God, don't they? Sinners try to make him out to be this very God right here that we're talking about, the God that hates people and hates people's actions. But what you're going to find as we get through this tonight is that these seven things encompass just about everything that a person could do, a human. These seven things bring together everything that mankind could ever do to fall, everything they could do against God, everything they could do against man. In fact, don't forget tonight what the number seven means in the Hebrew number system. The number of completion and perfection. Meaning that these seven things are the complete fall of humanity if you put them together and you begin to look at what they do to us. But keep in mind tonight that even though it says that there's seven things that God hates, it doesn't mean that the Lord only disapproves of these seven things. There's lots of things that make God angry. The psalmist said that God is angry with the wicked every day. There's many things that angers God, and I have to believe, listen to me carefully tonight, that even though Christ satisfied the wrath and the anger of God when he died on the cross, that a person that neglects, just foolishly chooses to do what God tells them not to do, they know the expectation. It must anger. Just like we read about in the Old Testament, it would say a lot of times that the anger of the Lord was kindled. Because think about it. It says in the book of Hebrews that when we do something knowing that we shouldn't do it anymore, it removes the sacrifice of Christ. You're playing with the very redemption when you do that. So keep in mind tonight again that this isn't all that God, let's say, hates, but the Holy Spirit put it in this perspective as we're going to look at it. But there is a word here I'm going to key on as we begin this tonight. And again, my notes will be available to you after this. And I'm sure after this, you're going to want to take all these notes with you. So if you want to, we'll have them ready for you after service. And I encourage you to get a copy, especially of this next part. Because that word abomination is used by a lot of people inside the church. I hear people use that word a lot about homosexuals. Amen?
Yes.
That's the number one time I hear them connect the word abomination. Is, oh, it's an abomination unto God. So I got curious as I was looking at this, and I believe the Lord inspired me to begin to dig in Scripture and find out how many times the word abomination was used connected to sin where God thinks something is an abomination. I found 31 abominations in the Bible. 31. And I want to read these before I clarify something to you, because here's what we've turned the word abomination into in the Bible. We've taken the word abomination to magnify sins we wouldn't commit, to make somebody else's sin look like the worst sin that could ever be done.
Yes.
Self-righteousness. Yes. Makes us look good. And so listen to these 31 abominations, and you're going to find also, like I said about the seven things that God hates, you're about to hear in 31 different places in the Bible where God calls anything mankind can ever do an abomination. Listen to this. Leviticus chapter 7, verse 18, it says that eating flesh of peace offerings on the third day is an abomination. Somebody said, that sounds crazy. What happened on the third day of the New Testament? You're messing with redemption's plan is what it was here. So there's listen to this. Leviticus 18, Leviticus 20, and Deuteronomy 23, all three of those passages do call homosexuality an abomination. Specifically, not one passage, three passages. Use that terminology. Deuteronomy chapter 7 says taking ornaments from idols when they're being destroyed is an abomination. Well, that's a message I could preach.
Yeah.
Because you know what that is? It's idols are removing anything in your life. And this may even tie into when we get to the part of the Ten Commandments that we don't have graven images and idols out before us. And I'll put this in there maybe. We'll just see how the Lord does it on that day. But this is saying that when you're going to destroy something and get it out of your life, don't keep the pieces you think you can control.
Yeah.
That's what a lot of people do. Well, I'm not participating in it. I just watch somebody else do it. It gives me pleasure. Romans chapter 1 says you're as guilty of their sin as they are. That's what it says. It says, offering an imperfect animal to God as a sacrifice is an abomination, Deuteronomy 17. Listen to this, Deuteronomy 18. You need to go read this part in detail. All the things that are spoken of on this next part. And because I can't really tell you all of them, but this is where you got to really look into things like Harry Potter and enchantments and things like that, dealing with magic and sorcery. Because listen to this right here. Traffic with demons is considered an abomination to God. And if you'll go read this in Deuteronomy 18, you'll see in that chapter all the things it's talking about. It's talking about people that call themselves what we would call psychics. They were called seers, and they would converse with familiar spirits is what the Old Testament says. So these people that supposedly, quote-unquote, read palms, or you call them on the phone and they do come up with some kind of information pertaining to your life, are talking to demon spirits that are moving through them. But you need to read in there what it says about all these things, because here's the thing, like I just said about Romans chapter 1. You may not participate in it yourself, but to get pleasure or be entertained by someone that does, even if it's Hollywood portrayal, makes you guilty. Yeah. Traffic with demons. Deuteronomy 22, listen to this one. Wearing clothes of the opposite sex is called an abomination to God. Wow. Right in Scripture. That's why I don't listen. Some people have chastised me and my kids, but I do not believe, even if it's for cute or for fun, at school we ain't going to let our kids dress opposite because the school's doing it. I don't think that's cute in the least sense at all, because the Bible says, don't do it.
Amen.
We've got to draw some lines somewhere, church.
Deuteronomy
23 says that bringing the hire of a harlot or a sodomite into God's house is an abomination to God. What does that mean? Listen to the words again. Bringing a harlot or a sodomite to hire inside of God's house. Two things that can be said of this. One, prostitutes were literally being utilized in the temple at different times throughout Israel's history. But it's interesting that the sodomite part was put in there, because here's what's happening today. Ministers, quote unquote, not of God, but of Satan, are standing behind pulpits, hired of churches, and they're homosexuals. We just heard that homosexuals are an abomination to God, right? Isn't that sin an abomination to God? So now we're seeing if they're hired into the church and it's being allowed inside the church and where God and His Word is being ministered. It says it right here, bringing the hire of sodomites into God's house is an abomination. Okay, so we got some of the ugly ones out of the way. We're like, man, those are terrible. Those are abominations. Listen to this, because we're fixing to get home now. Deuteronomy 25 says that cheating someone is an abomination.
Amen.
Now, I'm not looking around the room or asking for anything here, but have you ever cheated the IRS? You ever cheated if you found some money on the floor and you kept it for yourself? Kids, have you ever cheated at school and got answers on a test? An abomination to God. Whew, I told you it's not going to be easy tonight. Deuteronomy 27, making images is an abomination. I wonder, here's just my own personal thoughts. And it's kind of scary to get into my personal thoughts. But listen, there was no painters sitting at the Jordan River when Jesus was on the earth. So I wonder if we play with very dangerous ground making images of Christ that we don't know what He looked like. Think about what I'm saying. It's a scary place to find ourselves. Now, these next three in 1 Kings and 2 Kings were individual, and you'd really have to go study Ammon, Moab, and Zidon to understand what was being said, but it says those three idols, particularly idols of Ammon, idols of Moab, and idols of Zidon were abominations to God individually. Isaiah chapter 1 says incense offered, listen to this, by hypocrites is an abomination. Do you know what that represents in the New Testament church today? Praise and worship offered by hypocrites. I told you, this isn't going to be an easy message tonight. I don't even know if we'll get out of the abominations. We'll see. I intended on just reading them and going, but it ain't working out that way right now. Isaiah 66 says, eating unclean things is an abomination to God. Thank God in the New Testament that all the unclean became clean. So for us, what it means today is that there are things that we're not supposed to participate in and be around. Remember, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate. Touch not the unclean thing. So to say that there's not an unclean thing is incorrect under the new terms, because it says right there in the new covenant that there's things God considers unclean. Amen. Like the church drinking alcohol.
Amen.
The church doing drugs.
Amen.
You hear me, church?
Amen.
The church thinking that it's okay to sleep with somebody before you get married, because God forbid, you know, that you have a partner the rest of your life that you don't enjoy physically. Like, that's what it's all about. Well, people really ain't going to like me when we get into Ten Commandments, I'm telling you. I may not even be the pastor here by the time I'm done with them all. Jeremiah 32, listen to this one. Offering human sacrifices is an abomination to God. And we understand that on Old Testament terms, even in the North America, some of the Native Americans would do things like that in Mexico and other locations. But here's what I'd say to you about that today, where we wouldn't offer that anybody on an altar today. We do a lot of things, we allow and permit our children to do a lot of things that is sacrificing them on the altars of false gods. So we must be careful. We must be careful. Let's make it a little easier on you. Ezekiel 18 says that robbery is an abomination. Ezekiel 18 says murder is an abomination. Ezekiel 18 says that adultery is an abomination. Sounds like God's covering everything, doesn't it? Ezekiel 18 says to oppress someone else is an abomination. Ezekiel 18 even says that violence is an abomination. Ezekiel 18, that must be a very abominated chapter. But Ezekiel 18, listen to this one, says that breaking a vow is an abomination. Wow. Lord, you're not making this easy on us. Continuing in Ezekiel 18, listen to this. Lending and expecting interest from a brother is an abomination to God. Wow. Ezekiel 18, I have to say it because it's in the Word of God. Lying with a menstruous woman is an abomination. Right out of Scripture. When a woman's on her menstrual cycle, it says that description is abomination. Ezekiel 18, listen, oh, this one's one we don't battle with in here because we're good, we're holy, right? Listen to what it says, Ezekiel 18. Man, that's a good chapter, it seems like. Listen, hardness of heart is an abomination to God. Ezekiel 18, injustice is an abomination. Then it goes out to Daniel and Matthew, 2 Thessalonians, Revelation. It says that the worship of the Antichrist will be an abomination to God. And that's happening across America. There's a rise of a satanic church right now. It's happening all over the place, especially on college campuses. Leviticus chapter 19 says that incest, not insects like bugs, incest is an abomination to God. Family members lying with family members. It's an abomination. Listen to this one, Jesus. Well, this one will get you right here. I had to go read this. I'm like, oh my Lord. Luke 16 and 15, Jesus said, things that are highly esteemed by man are an abomination to the Lord. Well, that makes you think about a lot of stuff. The systems we participate in, the economics that we follow. It says things that are highly esteemed of man are an abomination to God. And then there's all kinds of sins that are listed by nations with a whole bunch of scriptures. I won't read them all. You can get them in my notes. But just because the word abomination is used, it doesn't mean, and keep this in your mind, that these 31 things are worse than any other. If you really listen to those 31 things, he literally covered everything a person could do wrong. It really did. It covered everything that a human being could ever do. So the next time that self-righteous person tells you that somebody's sin is an abomination to God, tell them that the very thing they just said out of their mouth is an abomination to God too, because the Bible says so. Because everything that we can do is an abomination. Everything is something that God would hate. Now keep in mind with this, that sin is sin. You've heard me teach this, but always keep in mind about sin. Here's something. Consequences will differ depending on the frequency of a sin that is committed and how much that sin affects other people. That's the only stipulation on God's consequence. There was always punishment, and there was always consequence, and it wasn't for the magnitude of a sin. Because a man that killed somebody and somebody that got caught in adultery could both be killed, according to the law. But here's what I would say to you tonight, according to Scripture. The consequence, or how harsh those consequences were based off of the frequency of the sin, a repeat offender. You hear that in our society, don't you? A repeat offender would be punished after sin and have greater consequence, even under the law of God. That's a biblical concept. And then someone that did things that affected other individuals would have greater consequences as well. In fact, the only levels or categories of sin that are in the Bible that you've heard me teach about before, there's two types of sin. There's a sin of ignorance, and there's a premeditated sin, meaning that you didn't know it was wrong, or you sat around and you thought it out. You might have even battled with it, and you still did. That's the only two types of sin that we find in the Bible. Study of Scripture reveals that sins were punished based off of their impact on present generations and future generations. Read it. People that like, take Israel, for example. They messed with the faith of the young generation when they were in the wilderness. What did God do to them because of that? They never even got into the promised land. They all died because of their impact and the consequences that trickled down to the generation behind them. So this is very important tonight that we get all of this. So in reality, all sin is abomination to God. You see how this is covered? It's all abomination to God. So let's look at these seven things in particular. I'll try to get through them, man. Try me in the keyword. Hallelujah. Number one was a proud look. This first one is all about pride. A proud look. It refers to the way that you look at yourself, not the way you're looking at someone else. And listen, the way you present yourself to others, and also the way that you choose to view people. That's all proud look. Understand that again. The way you view yourself, the way that you present yourself to other people, and the way you view others. That's all what it means to have a proud look. Always remember this as a child of God. Humility is not an option when it comes to God. I said humility is not an option when it comes to God. In fact, the Bible says that God, it uses the word in the King James, it says abase. That word means that he will smash to the ground the proud. It says he'll lift up the humble. The humility spoken of here is not being well-mannered. It's not opening a door for a lady or something like that. That's just being good-natured and mild-mannered or something. This is speaking of a proud look, humility of having a lowly heart, of being meek like Jesus was. It means that you don't do anything or think anything that places yourself above someone else. That's easy, isn't it? Let me say it like this. To make someone feel like they have to look up at you all the time will make God look down on you. That's good. Because if we're not careful as Christians, I've done this myself. I'll look at them old, dirty, rotten little sinners and make them feel like they have to look up to come to where I'm at in order to find the grace and the mercy of God. Can I tell you that when we do that, God's looking down on us and it probably breaks his heart. And in fact, he says he hates a proud look. And so pride is the most destructive force inside of the sin nature of humanity. I believe it's why it's mentioned first on the list of things that God hates. Pride. God hates pride. Listen to a few things the Bible says about pride. Proverbs 11, chapter 2, or chapter 11, verse 2. 11, chapter 2. How do you do that? Proverbs 11 and 2. It says, when pride cometh, then cometh shame. But with the lowly is wisdom. Proverbs 13 and 10. Only by pride cometh contention. You know what contention is? Fighting and quarrels. Difficulty between people. Only pride, or by pride, cometh contention. So, you know what that tells me? When two people argue or get in a fight, according to Scripture, pride is what brought that about. Think about that next time, married folks, when you're at home. Well, they just never think about it my way. Pride brings contention. Proverbs 14, for y'all get off that. I threw you up on the rocks. In the mouth of the foolish is a rod of pride. Wow. What does that mean? It means that you beat people up with the things you say because you think you're better than them. Proverbs 16:18. We quote this one all the time. Pride goeth before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Destruction. If you see somebody's life in a wreck, pride is what brought it about. That's what Scripture's saying. Proverbs 29:23. A man's pride will bring him what? Low. But honor shall uphold the humble in spirit. These are all terrible realities of what pride does to a person. Keep in mind tonight that this is something capable in all of us. Pride is the strongest force in the sin nature, in the Adamic nature, the original sin, whatever you want to call it, that's in you, that other person that you were before you were saved. Pride is your greatest enemy, the old man. It is the number one thing that will grab you. God will deal with pride, according to the Bible. Matthew 23:12, Jesus said this, whosoever shall exalt himself will be abased. You heard me say that a moment ago. He that humbles himself shall be exalted. James chapter 4, verse 6, God says, but he will giveth more grace, is what James says. Wherefore he saith, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Sometimes people, when they pray, people that are Christians that are seeking God, can't get answers from him because of their pride. James 4:10, humble yourselves in the sight of God and he'll lift you up. 1 Peter 5:5-6, if anybody knew about pride, it was Peter. Mr. God, even though everybody else will deny you, I won't do it. That's pride right there. 1 Peter 5, likewise, listen to this. Ye younger, that's some of you in this area right here. I don't see anybody else in that category. I'm just missing. You younger, submit yourselves to the older. Ye all of be of one subject to one another, be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, and he gives grace to the humble. That's the second time we've heard that. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he will exalt you in due time. This pride thing won't go anywhere with God. Anywhere. Just ask Job how far pride will go. That's really what God was after with Job. If you look at the end of the book, and you start reading before God brings the blessing, Job starts realizing. Why do you think God had to ask Job the questions that he asked? Remember that part of the story where he's breaking pottery to scratch off his boils, and his wife and his friends have come to him, and they've all ridiculed him and criticized him, and some of them told him, you know, hey, if you weren't a sinner, you know, this wouldn't be happening. Well, just because something's happening don't mean you're always in sin. But God was working in Job. That's what trial's for, right? Is to eliminate things in us so God can promote us in grace and promote us in faith with him. And so Brother Job's going through a trial so God can get pride out of his life. And it's proven in this, where one time the only time we see Job start to question, God, why is this happening to me? Pride, me. God answers him. He says, where were you when I created the universe?
Yes.
Man, God lays it down on him in that chapter. He starts asking, Lord, what was this? Well, where were you when I created the animals? Where were you since you think you're so good, Brother Job? That's another message, probably for another time. But at the end of the story, he writes all of this down and shows about the humility that God was trying to operate in his life, and God used Job to show us what he can do if we'll truly humble ourselves. Even Jesus, the Bible says, suffered to the points of obedience and humility to make sure that pride could never come in. It says that in the Bible. He was at all points tempted, yes, without sin. 40 days, 40 nights in the wilderness, Satan came after him in another time, trying to get pride, remember? He said, man, you can have all of this.
Yeah.
Remember that? Man, he even used this. Well, this is a good one. This is what Satan did to him. You know, the Bible says, you're the Son of God. It says you could jump off of here before you hit the ground. The angels will stop you. He was quoting Scripture out of the book of Psalms. Jesus told him, yeah. But it also says this. It says that you should not test the Lord thy God. Pride is an opportunity that Satan's going to use in every one of our lives to begin the downfall. Remember this as we go into the second part. A person ruled by pride can never be ruled by God. That's good. A person ruled by pride can never be ruled by God because pride is their ruler. Second one's a lying tongue. These, the rest of these won't be as long as the first, but trust me. We must be, as a church, and it's sad that I even have to bring this up, but the Holy Spirit put it in this passage, so it's necessary to talk about. Remember, I said these were warnings, things that God wanted to protect us from, to make sure it doesn't come into our character. And it's sad to say that the church has to be reminded that we must be people of integrity and honesty. To do what's right when nobody's around. To know that our private life is more valuable than our public life. And if our private life is arranged the right way, our public life will display Christ. But it's amazing that we even have to bring this up in the world that we live in now. I've heard it said, I can remember when I was a little kid and my dad, who wasn't he wasn't good at integrity. But here's one thing my dad did put into me from the time I was a little boy. He wasn't a good man. You've heard me tell stories about him. But here's one thing I can remember from the time I was a little bitty. On a handshake, if my daddy said this is going to get done and he shook a man's hand, it got done.
Amen.
But in today's society, you have to go put it on a piece of paper with ink and you have to have a notary do it because nobody can be trusted anymore. A lying tongue, the Bible says, God hates. And it's unfortunate because all in church, we got people that lie. They break vows. They make up stories. They tell someone, I'll do it, and they never do it. One of the places we tell people a lot of times that we'll do it and we never do is we tell them, I'll pray for you. And we never do. Stop right then and do it if you're going to promise that.
Amen.
That's when they need it. Amen. Care where you're at. As long as you ain't driving down the road, they're in another car. Y'all don't need to stop like that. It's probably the only time. But God despises a lying tongue. In fact, he said he hates it. We know the meaning of a liar as a talebearer or someone that stretches the truth, but listen to some other descriptions of lying in the Bible. 1 John 1 and 10 says that if we say we haven't sinned, we make God a liar and his word's not in us.
Amen.
Oof. So we're not just lying if we just tell a false story to somebody. If we say that we don't sin, then we're a liar. 1 John 2 and 4 says, he that says, I know the Lord, but does not keep his commands, is a liar. And the truth is not in him. 1 John 2 and 22 says, who is a liar but he that denies Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist. Because he denies the Father and the Son.
Amen.
Some denominations out there need to listen to that part.
Amen.
Because they deny the Father and the Son. You'll get what I'm saying later.
Yeah.
Those oneness churches, I'll just put it out there.
Yeah.
1 John 4 and 20 says, listen to this, you heard this one this morning. If a man says, I love God but hates his brother, he is a what?
Liar.
He's a liar. For how can he love not his brother who he's seen, but he can love God who he hasn't seen? So let me put these in perspective a little bit. It says that people that say they aren't sinners are liars. People that say they are saved but continue to live in sin are liars. People that deny Christ, his deity, and that there's a Father in heaven are liars. And people that say they love God but they hate their brother are liars. This isn't me saying, I get no joy from stuff like this, because you ought to see the looks I'm getting from you. This is not me. This is gospel right here. God hates this inside the church.
Amen.
So this lying tongue goes farther than we realize. The lying tongue has a consequence all to itself. What I mean by that is that a person that continues in these ways that you just heard has a guarantee from God. Just like I said earlier, if it's not repented of and changed in their life, they have a guarantee from God that they're going to get something special, if you want to call it special. Listen to Revelation chapter 21, verse 8. But the fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, that's all humans, because we just heard 31 abominations. He got us all. We're all guilty. Murderers, whoremongers. You know what that word means? That's a big King James word for somebody that sleeps around. That's what it is. Sorcerers. Well, Harry Potter better find God. You know they're making that a required reading in our public schools now. Parents. Where we hear the word of God say that we're to stay away from this stuff. Now they're forcing it on our kids. Idolaters and all
liars
shall have their part in the lake of fire. We are the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which will be the second death. Third one, hands that shed innocent blood. This doesn't really have a hidden meaning to it like some of these others. You don't have to search a long way to find this. The surface meaning of this really does carry the weight of the text, that God hates people that shed innocent blood. God hates people that kill without cause. Why? It means that their heart was so full of rage and driven by violence that they can't control the fury that's in their life. A violent and an angry person can never be right with God. Why do you think the Bible talks so much about be angry but sin not? James says that anger worketh not the righteousness of God in your life. You know what that means? That a person that stays angry all the time, that God's not able to do anything in them that's good or holy. I used to be that person. Anger used to drive me, man. I told y'all stuff. And see, today I can laugh about it. It's so stupid. But I would get so mad about so little bitty things. I would throw shoes at walls and doors. And when I'd finally come out of the blackout of all the anger, there would be shoes stuck in the doors in my house. I'd be like, how did that happen? I look back now and think, my Lord, how was I such an angry person? Some people might think today that I might get short at times, and I really don't. I might get frustrated with people's actions, but you should have known me 15 years ago. I'm glad you didn't, because it was a different man, I promise you. I was a man that was waiting. I was on the edge all the time, just waiting for you to say something or do something. My wife just walked out, but she could tell you. Don't go asking stories about the preacher, okay? But she could tell you how bad I used to embarrass her in public before I was saved. Because if you looked at me the wrong way, or if you looked at her in a way that I thought she did, even though it really wasn't that way, I'd start turning tables over like I was Jesus at the temple. I'm talking literally. In restaurants, I'd embarrass my wife. In grocery stores, man, I've went through the whole shelf with stuff on it fall over, with me and two guys going through a shelf. I was an angry, angry man. But I want to say something about this before I move on, because here's something I believe is very applicable to today with our society. Our society feeds on this anger and this violence thing. Whether it's sports or the record-breaking fight last night. Think about this. Our society has designed itself, even in video games, movies, and television shows, yes, where violence can be platformed and put into the hearts of individuals, especially men and young men, because they struggle with anger. And so our adversary has done very well at keeping people attached to those things and making sure that it'd be a reality in their life to shed innocent blood. I think that shedding innocent blood is not just, and I said I'm not going to go very deep on this, but we understand the concept of killing a person. But what about if we're just killing animals for the fun of it? Horn hunters instead of meat hunters. Now, I know I'm going to make some people mad on that, but I choose, and I believe with all of my heart, you don't kill anything that you're not going to eat. I believe that with everything in me. And so I believe there's violence and anger in your heart and murderous intentions if all you do is shoot an animal just for the thrill of it. If Jesus judges the thoughts and the motives of the heart, don't you think that he already knows why you're doing that? What it's feeding inside of you? Don't do this, but you might as well just go out and kill somebody. Because all you're doing is doing it to an animal inside of your heart. Now, if you're providing for your family, it's different. Right. Amen?
Yeah.
Way different.
Amen.
We must be careful. We've turned a lot of things in our society into sport just to feed the desire for the sin nature of anger and craving and violence. Military guys really struggle with this, because all we're taught is anger and violence. That's what they put into us. Be angry. Do whatever you got to do. Be violent. That'll make you the best military person you can be. That makes you survive when you're in combat. But man, it's hard to undo even after you get saved. It takes a move of God in your life. So be careful in feeding that deep craving in a person's heart, or to hurt or to injure someone, or even benefit from someone else's pain. Amen?
Amen.
Still with me?
Amen.
Can I keep going?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Next one. A heart that devises wicked imaginations. This is an interesting one. This means, and I had to do some digging on this, think about this. This means that God hates the person that plans evil in private. Lord, I just bust them upside their head. I told you it's going to get us all. But not just that, I want you to think about these. There's scripture. Scripture's full of examples of this. King Saul. He was almost at the top of the list when I was going through this, thinking about, you know, what's some biblical examples of people that would sit around and have wicked imaginations towards somebody? King Saul was right there, as bad as he wanted David dead. Absalom. Well, he's another that sat around with wicked imaginations towards his own father, David. Well, it's like David had everybody after him. And Absalom would even get to the point that he would devise these plans. And if you remember in the teaching and preaching that I've done here about this, there was a man named Ahithophel that was both David and Absalom's counselor. Ahithophel was kinfolk to Bathsheba, so he was still angry and would not forgive David for what he did to Bathsheba's husband. So the Bible says this, he would speak godly counsel in David's ear, run to Absalom and tell Absalom where David was going to be and what he was going to do, and tell Absalom what to do to kill David. Wicked imaginations, devising plans and schemes to hurt people. David did the same thing. I believe that's why Absalom did what he did to David. God was bringing consequence back into David's life. Remember all the devising that David did? Listen, you might think, oh, I don't do this right here. A little pride after David did it. But listen to this. Listen, we don't sit down and think out a well-thought plan about murdering somebody. But you know what we do a lot of times? We do come up with wicked imaginations and devise plans on how to cover up our sins so nobody will know. It's no different. We do make plans. Listen, I find this as a reality, and unfortunately, let me say it differently. This part is not done as these biblical characters as we see, as often as I see it done in marriage today. What do you mean by that, preacher? It's almost a joke to a lot of married couples. But how many times have I as a pastor sat in with counseling in married couples? Listen to this. Where the woman plans this thing behind his back, or the man plans this thing around her back. It's not just adultery. I'm talking money. I'm talking anything that's done without the knowledge of two being one flesh. Amen. Wicked imaginations. It's real. There's a man named Haman that lived for wicked imaginations, trying to kill all the Jews, and Esther was called for such a time as that. Judas Iscariot had a wicked imagination against Jesus, all for 30 pieces of silver. Do you know that 30 pieces of silver was the equivalent that you bought a slave off the auction block with? Jesus was worth a slave to Judas. Sanballat was another in Nehemiah's day that devised wicked plans against the work of God. Joseph's brothers had wicked imaginations and set plans in place to get rid of their brother. Listen, just because God gave him favor and had a call on his life. The list can go on all through the Bible. But we have to be careful to protect ourselves from matters like this. This means that we aren't to plan wickedness or attempt to bring harm to others no matter what they do to us. Like you were hearing this morning, brother, neighbor, enemy, we cannot bring revenge. God will avenge for us. It's the equivalent of Jesus being beaten, his beard being pulled out, and being crucified, and he never said a word. Even though the Bible specifically says that he could have called legions of angels at any point to deliver him. Yet he didn't. He didn't have any vile thought, any wicked imagination. In fact, one of the last things he would say with the breath that he was gasping at the end of his life was, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." What this really comes down to, a heart that devises wicked imaginations, what it really comes down to is forgiveness. Yes, I said the word we don't like to hear. Because anybody that would sit around and devise a plan to harm somebody is not operating under the Christian principles of forgiveness.
Amen.
It comes down to forgiveness. A person that plots and schemes wickedness is certainly overcome by the actions of someone else towards them. So we have to let that go. We have to be people of mercy. We have to be people of forgiveness. We have to be people of kindness, just like God is to us. Next one, feet that run quickly to mischief. This means that God hates, isn't that the word it used? God hates those that run to evil or sin. Let's just put the term in there, what it means. So what it's saying is God hates people that don't even think about sin, they just go do it. Now remember, he's trying to warn the church. So church, did you know that you can fall? Did you know, don't be a liar right now, did you know that you can commit sin? The Bible says that he hates people, individuals that run quickly towards sin. Psalm 7:11 says this. I quoted it a moment ago, but listen, God judges the righteous and he's angry with the wicked every day. God's angry with the wicked every day. Every day. This should be understood as the Lord's continual frustration with the wicked. So get this today, and I'm going to shorten this down. We that call ourselves redeemed must stay away from wickedness. The Bible says that let anyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. We're not people that get saved and continue in sin. That's not the call of the gospel. What does it show about the power of the blood of Jesus if you continue in what you say you were saved from? Not just the thing you were in when you first got saved. What about the continual change of God's grace continuing in your life after you're saved? Like it says in Philippians chapter 1, where it says that he that hath begun a perfect work will complete it in the day of the Lord. That means that at the rapture, it'll be done. You'll finally be completed when you get a glorified body.
Amen. Yes.
But until then, we're desperate for the grace of God. We need it on a daily basis. The person that doesn't understand how desperate you are for God's grace every day is doomed and destined to fall. If you're not depending on his grace, calling out for mercy from God every day because you know the human nature and what it's capable of, you're walking down a dangerous path. God, help me today. I need you. We have to not only stay away from evil, but listen to this. There's a good truth in the book of Thessalonians. Go read it. And it says this, not only are we to abstain from committing sin, it says to abstain from the very appearance of evil. That's a whole different ballgame, guys. All these people that think we can participate in sin in moderation in the church have lost, and I wish I had some better words than the way I'm going to say it. They have lost their stinking minds. There is no moderate sin. Not one in the Bible anywhere. But the Bible commands to abstain from the very appearance of sin.
That's right.
Not just the act itself. So yet again, the new covenant raises it to a level where these people are stepping all over the grace of God.
Yeah.
And he says, don't just put yourself in a scenario where you run from the action. Get the action or the opportunity for that action completely away from your life. That means you have to know what you're drawn to. And be honest with yourself. Listen, you've heard me say this before, but this is vitally important. If you're going to stay away from evil and not commit sin, you're going to have to shut some things off in your life. If it's a struggle for you. Anybody that struggles with one of the biggest sins in the world right now in the church is pornography. And listen to me very carefully. Because here's what I believe about it. It's such a strong sin. But here's what I believe. Because it's adultery. If you're a married person, and if you're not, the Bible calls it a whoremonger. I mean, you're watching it with your own eyes, and it's getting into your mind, and whatever's in your mind is going to be in your heart. Whatever your heart is going to become an action in your life. You've heard me teaching on this over the last few months. But here's what I'd say about that sin. Abstain from the appearance, right? Not the action, the appearance.
Yes.
So if you have a struggle with something that strong, maybe it's time you put down the smartphone altogether. Maybe it's time you disconnect from the internet and not even give Satan an opportunity for one of those little pop-ups to come up on your screen and say, oops, I didn't mean to do that. Abstain from the appearance.
Yeah.
It's vitally important. This is why my wife and I decided with our kids a lot of things that they're not allowed to be around because we're going to be biblical and we're not just going to keep them. Parents and grandparents, I think this is a vital thing in our lives. Listen to this. As leaders and a pastor, I do the same thing as a pastor. For you guys, that's why I preach messages like this. I don't want you to get to the door of sin and have to make a decision and say, should I do this? A true spiritual leader's job, the number one obligation of true spiritual leadership, I'm talking about pastors, I'm talking about parents, I'm talking about spouses, I'm talking about grandparents, whatever you are in spiritual leadership, and you are to somebody, it's to make sure that they never even get on that path to get to that door. Abstain from the very appearance of people. Talk to people, man, well, Josh, just can't quit smoking. Or, do you have cigarettes around? Yeah. They're on my dashboard. We either quit driving a vehicle or chunk them things not out of the window, put them in the trash somewhere. And don't do like some people, give them to somebody else that smokes. You're not doing anything for the cause of Christ.
That's right.
Let somebody else see him, okay? But listen to me, church. We've got to get to a place as a church, we understand this principle that we have to abstain from the very appearance of it. Because here's what I've learned. The Bible says we're epistles known and read of all men. What we are, how we present ourselves to people and the way they view us is the way they view God who they can't see. So the things they find us surrounding ourselves with are the, listen, are the things that become permissible to unsaved people.
Yes.
If the church even looks like it's participating, then it's okay. I wonder how many people are going to bust hell wide open because of these so-called ministers that are teaching that alcohol is okay.
Yeah.
I'm talking about not just the church people. I'm talking about people that they're wrestling with it. My Lord, have you even thought about this part of this alcohol conversation, you dummies that are listening to me online right now? One of the greatest men of God in our movement, Dave Lewis, started Teen and Life Challenge.
Yes.
He started it because of alcohol and drugs. Yet somehow people think it's okay. The man was moved by the anointing of the Holy Spirit to get people off of drugs and alcohol. Yet, and nicotine as well. Yet today, we have people that are teaching that it's okay in moderation.
Come on, no.
The man gave his entire life. And now it's worldwide teen challenge. Getting people delivered by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Now the church is saying it's okay to do. Watched a video the other day, and it almost made me vomit in the place where I watched it at. A man that calls himself a preacher of the gospel has one of the largest churches in this country, not in Houston. Okay? I just wanted to clarify that because it's one of the largest. This is another large one. And you can find this. I'm not making this up. Walked to the pulpit, Budweiser in hand. Set it on the pulpit, preached, and drank in between points. Just to show that God's grace will come from. Man, how I wish God would bring fire down from heaven sometimes. But because he's merciful, much more merciful than me, because I would have been like Elijah, been like, everybody get the swords and just cut them all down. Maybe that's why I'll never be in leadership in the assemblies. Because I'd line them all up. Every one of you, get right here. Let me talk to you. Boom, you're dead. I just can't find it in my heart. Stupidity is stupidity. My God, how did a man that came from the gutter like me, that grew up in the vile trenches of evil and sin, that participated in it, how are you going to tell me, supposedly with the same Holy Spirit in you that's in me, that it's okay to do where I got delivered from? I mean, come on, if you lost our minds. It's crazy. And yet the church wants to argue about where the line's at. How far can I go before I fall off with God? Friend, if you're having that conversation with yourself, you're probably already past the line. Because God ain't waiting for you to not sin. He's waiting for you to get to the point where you despise it so much that you just set a standard that says, I won't even put myself around it. I'll abstain from all of it to make sure that I'm not misled, nor is anybody else misled about my God. Praise the Lord. So we must be quick to turn away from evil. Young people, I wish I could tell you something better. All of you that are in school, look at me. Wish I could say something different than what I'm about to say right now. I wish it was going to be easy for you once you get saved and go back to school, but unfortunately the ones that you're in school with, they love evil. They love it. It's a part of their humanity to love evil. But God's put you there. You've been saved. You've been spirit-filled. You've been empowered with the Holy Ghost. It's God And it's the same power that Jesus had. And you've been placed in that spot to shine the light of Christ and show them that they don't have to live the life that they're living.
Amen.
If you'll go in and you'll abstain from the appearance, even though it's going to be a lonely thing to do, if you'll do it, God will give you favor. And even if one gets saved because of your example, then it's all worth it.
Amen.
It's all worth it. Stand your ground. Remember last year when I was, or the year before actually, when I was working with the basketball team in Atlanta, the basketball coach, and him and I are real good friends. He moved on to Corsicana. In fact, he follows us online. He may be watching right now. So Coach Playborn, if you are, hi. But he moved off, and we would work on things with basketball. He's asked me to come in. I preach to his athletes, and he asked me to do that once a week. I remember him and I, you know, I tried to the best I could encourage him in faith, and he's a good man of God. He's grown a lot, and I love what I saw God do in his life. And sometimes I think where I was really trying to get with the students, I think I might have been sent for him more than the students, you know, because he was a Pentecostal believer that was just being attacked constantly by the people that were working with him. Yeah. You know, coaches have no idea the impact they have on students' lives, and they surely don't carry the regard of the responsibility they have. And that's something I want to change in our community and the school district. But that's another story for another time. But Coach Claiborne, I used to talk to him all the time. I'm like, listen, he wouldn't play. I like this about it. I'd come in and during basketball practice, he wouldn't play the filth that everybody else played, but he wouldn't play Christian music. He would just play instrumental stuff. I was like, man, come on and just cross the line. And look, but this is a real thing to teachers. They're so threatened by their employers. They're told, if you do this, and listen, that's a lie. The state of Texas doesn't demand anywhere that they can't talk about Christ. They're being lied to. The educational system has just bought into that. But our Texas state legislation says that if something that's not godly spoken of, we have a law that's called equal time, then God has to be spoken of as equal as much as that other thing was. It's in our law system in Texas. Yet they've been told that no Christian, no this, no that, and da da da. So I was like, okay, look, if you won't do it, I'll do it. They can't fire me. All they do is kick me out of here. So I started coming in every day and putting Christian music on during basketball practice. First couple times the guys would come out, I'd get done preaching with them. And you know how it is when you get preached at a little bit. I'd really challenge those guys. First day I walked into the basketball team, I asked them, how many of you say you're saved? They all put their hands up. After that first sermon, I said, how many of you think you're saved now? They just kind of looked at me. I was like, no, I'm not trying to hurt your feelings. I just want you to see the magnitude of where we stand right now. The church doesn't even hear this stuff. They don't understand it. And so they come out, they hear the Christian music, and they're just like, what is this? It was almost like their heads were going to spin around on their bodies, you know? But before the year was over, they were listening to that music themselves. It was on their phones, on their iPods. And listen, I don't know where their walks with God was. I just know that for that time, we were having church when I went into the school district.
Praise God.
And we were able to go in there and do some things like that. And so we got a big work ahead of us, but we can't think that evil's not out there. Satan has done a very good thing about putting evil everywhere we are, but we've got to make sure we protect ourselves from it. Next one, a false witness that speaketh lies. This is not the same thing as the lying. Listen to this. This is better known in the church. Ooh, I might have to talk to Brother Dore about this one. Listen, this is better known as gossip.
Yeah.
Backbiting.
Yes.
And slander. Which it never happens in our church. But unfortunately, there is a lot of this that goes on among churches.
Yes.
Boy, I'm the biggest target most of the time. Just because of truth, I'm the biggest target. And where they won't tell me, because they don't have the courage enough to do it, they find the other person is just like them and they'll go tell them about it. Yes. Oh, I don't like this. Come tell me, I'm a big boy, I can handle it, I promise you. And I'm not going to hurt your feelings. I will be very nice about it. I always am. God has worked in me. I'm not going to be the old man that just wanted to call the fire down. I promise. I will deal gracefully with that situation because I want to hear your opinion. But here's what I do not accept. Is your opinion going to somebody else? And then that opinion going to somebody else? Because just like that little child's game that we used to play at school where they would whisper, the dinosaur is purple and he walks on green grass. By the time it got to the end of the chain and everybody was done whispering, there's a football player that had a spider up his nose. You know the game I'm talking about. It all's twisted up before it's over with. I don't know where that came from. That just came out of my imagination. But anyways, this, Gossip is the cancer. Listen to this. Gossip is the cancer that rots the core of any person's spirit.
Amen.
It is the thing. Why do you think Facebook is so popular? Why do you think there's billions of people across the world on a website or on a telephone where they can listen, send private messages to other people without anybody knowing about it?
Yeah.
It's gossip.
Yeah.
I don't need to know what your dog's doing. I surely don't need to know about it while you're in the bathroom. And I sure don't need you telling me about what you saw somebody doing in the bathroom about their dog. We're infatuated with it. Satan, the boy's crafty.
Yes.
Yeah, it has good uses. I'm not knocking it. But be honest with yourself. Because we who say we're without sin, we're liars.
Yeah, right.
Be honest with yourself.
That's right.
I abstain from the appearance. Because I might know that in me there might be a tendency to get over on one of those messages and tell somebody that I confide in and trust what I really think about the situation. And that's backbiting.
Amen.
Here's what I would say, and I'd even go forward as far with this, a false witness that speaketh lies, is this. If you didn't see the action yourself, you shouldn't say anything about it.
Amen. Right.
Because you're bearing false witness. You weren't even there.
Right.
And to pass it on makes you as guilty as the person that did it in the first place.
Amen.
So we're told to stay away from all of this. Really, preachers, or more than that in Proverbs 6, 1 Peter 4 and 15. Don't let any of you suffer as a murderer or as a thief or as an evildoer or as a busybody in other men's matters.
Amen.
Wow. I hope God don't send no fire down on me right now. But there was a man that was probably way before his time, dying at an early age. I don't know if he was saved. That ain't my place to know. Hank Williams Sr. How many of y'all know his name?
Amen.
Yeah, nobody? Y'all come on, man. Don't leave me up here by myself right now. Acting like y'all don't know who Hank Williams Sr. is. Come on, y'all don't make me sing. Hank Williams Sr. did sing a song. Mind your own business. Remember that song? Y'all are all going to hell. Hallelujah. So am I, because I know the song. I don't even know why it popped in my mind. But it fits, so we're going with it. I'll repent later. Listen to this. You know what the second part of that verse said? Mind your own business. Because if you're minding your own business, you sure won't be minding mine. I ain't saying there's nothing biblical about that. But you can't be backbiting or being a busybody in anybody else's business if you're taking care of your own affairs. And I believe that with the truth. If you would take care of your own stuff, two things would happen. Number one, you wouldn't be involved in everybody else's stuff. And number two, if you take care of your own stuff will get resolved.
Amen.
You might find out you ain't got nothing to talk about unless you're talking to God.
There you go.
Leviticus 19:16 says, "You shall not go up and down as a talebearer among thy people. Neither shalt thou stand against the blood of any neighbor, of your neighbor. I am the Lord." Proverbs 10:18, "He that hideth hatred with lying lips, and he that uttereth a slander is a what? You get the point, gossip's terrible. And I firmly believe that if we concern ourselves with our own affairs, like I said, and our own maturity, growing in the Lord continually, we wouldn't even have time to bother with anybody else's stuff. We have so much to change in our own lives. It amazes me. In fact, this is in my spirit, I'm just going to say it. As much as we get involved in other people's affairs, I think we do that to hide the fact that we know we need to be changing something in our own. That's what Jesus said. It's biblical. Think about it. Don't look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye until you pull the plank out of your own. Yet it's easier to look at all the things going on somebody's Facebook page, Instagram, chat, Snapchat, all that other stuff, and say, you know what? They're bad. But they ain't got to look at your page yet. And so we point in places that we don't even belong. Let's just deal with our own stuff. Social networking and other technology have a good, they have a good use. They really do. But we need to stay out of other people's business. That song's going to be in y'all's head, I'm telling you. Those of you that know that song, The rest of you, don't go look it up. It'll be a sin. I command you in the name of the Lord. Don't go look that song up. Gosh, I done ruined it. Y'all are out of here. How many more I got? I got one more. Y'all with me?
Amen.
Last one. Ooh, this is the easiest one to deal with right here. Because this never happens. Number seven thing that God hates. I feel like I'm on Family Feud right now. Number seven. But this is probably the number one answer. After pride. He that sows discord, not among the neighbor. Remember, the neighbor's unsaved folk.
Yep.
He that sows discord among the brethren. So this tells us this entire passage, these seven things, has to be talking about church people. Right. People that say they're saved. Because you ain't sowing discord among people that are called brothers if you ain't saved yourself.
Amen.
That's what I told you this morning. Yep. What an awful thing to do. I just don't understand this in church. And maybe it's because I see it from a different perspective as a pastor. Maybe it's because a lot of the discord is about me, about the decisions I make, the decisions that I'm not making under personal conviction, but I'm making decisions based off of what I feel God leading me to do. Discord, where we would go around and talk and say, you know what, Brother Charles did this in the church, and I hate that. I can't stand that. Well, Pastor Josh, he killed the church because we did $1 million building where you voted to. I didn't just come up with that thing overnight. That was a 7-year plan in my mind that God put in my heart, and I didn't even pursue it until God confirmed it through other individuals that didn't even know I was praying about it.
Come on.
I wasn't even ready to do it. To be honest, I was scared. And God worked a lot of fear out of my life. It ain't easy to have $1 million faith, guys, especially when it ain't on paper. When you're looking at paper and it says you can't do it, that paper ain't lying. Numbers don't lie to you. But when God's involved, all things are possible, right?
Yeah.
To them that believe. That's the key to it. And it took that process to work those things out of my life. But here's what I found out during that time. If people didn't like colors, if they didn't like certain things, if they didn't like the layout of the building, you better believe there was discord some. And it's ridiculous. What do we come to the house of God for? Preferences? We come to the house of God to be in the presence of the Lord and let the power of God move in our lives.
Amen.
It's scary. But this is so important to God that he says he hates it. People that are the controversy in the church body are being used by the enemy in ways that are most of the time unknown to them. I don't believe for one second that people that do this sit around trying to dream up a plan of how to hurt me or hurt the church. I don't believe that. I believe that there's probably a weakness in their life or something going on that's got the best of them. And all they know to do is to deflect what's going on in their life and trying to put it on somebody else. I really believe that. But unfortunately, Satan uses them, and they don't even know they're being used, to stir up controversy, to bring issues inside of the church body where Satan knows that the Bible says that unity, the anointing of God, is like unity among the brethren. He knows that. That if we're not in one accord, nothing's going to happen. So the desire to stir up issues in the church, go back to the very first thing in the list, and it's pride. So the first and the last really coexist with one another. And I don't want to dwell on this matter because there's a lot of things that can insert itself into this category. But here's a few. Finances. I don't understand how a piece of paper can rule the heart of a person so bad that they'll make accusations about churches. It's not here. It's all over churches. Men or women that get elected to boards who think it's their place to tell the pastor yes or no. It's not biblical.
Right.
Now, if he's out of order, it is biblical.
Yeah.
If he's out of scripture, it is biblical. But in the scenario, if he's stealing from God, then you better believe it's biblical. But in a scenario, and it's unfortunately the most of the time, that's how it is. They think that their call of God is to stand as the measure between God and the people and make sure that the pastor doesn't hurt those people. Decisions are another area where this happens. Direction is another area that this happens. Well, I don't think that's what God wants us to do. Well, why aren't you in the pulpit then, honey? Why didn't God call you to pastor the church? It's easy to make all the decisions or think this is what it needs to do or this is how it needs to be done and be able to go home at night and lay your head on the bed or on the pillow and not have any concerns. It's another thing to be the guy that's standing right here that has all of it coming at him at one time. Knowing that I'm not making a decision for my own benefit. I'm going to say this just because some of these folks don't come to this church anymore. share with me, just bear with me. Not being ugly about it, but I'm just going to say it like this. Do you know that thing that God gave us next door, that I wouldn't personally use that building, and I still hesitate to do it today? Because of accusations in our own church that I built that thing for me. I quit bringing guys from the hood to play basketball because of the accusations that I heard. Abstain from the appearance. I felt that protecting the reputation of the church and of remaining above reproach was more important at that time than ministry. That's the position that people put me in. But they're sleeping good. Have no idea what they're doing. Have no idea what's being said when they do that. I didn't build that thing. You think I go to sleep at night okay with the fact that we have $1 million of debt? It breaks my heart. I believe God can just provide it for us. But you've heard me say it before, that until we learn to sacrificially give, he's not going to drop a miracle in us. Our generation has to learn what it is to give for a generation that we may not ever see. And if we get that, and that principle happens, then God will do something amazing. He's already shown us that he can do it, hasn't he? Recently. The concern of the church shouldn't be finances, decisions, direction, preferences, and opinions. That's the concern of the pastor and the board. The concern of the church should be lost souls, discipleship, outreach, foreign missions, and making heaven.
Amen.
If you continually seek them five things, you ain't going to have nothing else to worry about.
Amen.
Let me say them again. Lost souls. You discipling people and being discipled. Outreach, going and getting people saved. Foreign missions, what are you doing to see people saved on other continents? And making heaven yourself.
Amen.
Actually getting into heaven. That's a lot to have to deal with in your own life.
Amen.
So we should all get involved in the mission of the church, not just by being ministered to in the church, but we need to be involved in the ministry of the church.
Right.
We should never be the source or the parties involved in church conflict. I've sat down with many, but and I say this with respect, okay? With many gray-haired ministers, because the Bible calls them guys, that's their crown of wisdom. Whether it was Brother Morrow, Brother Hooten, I sat down with him numerous times. In your living room, did I not? When we'd have discussions, and you know what my discussions were? How did you survive all of the onslaught that comes against you because you're just trying to do what God put in your heart? He said, they would all tell me the same thing. Young man, there's no definitive answer. You're just going to have to seek God. And though nobody else will, you're just going to have to keep seeking God.
Amen.
And that's what I've learned. But it's unfortunate that every person, and it's going to be true in your life too, if you follow the will and the plan of God for your life, people are going to come after you. They're going to stir controversy. I've heard all kinds of crazy stuff about me and my family. It's almost entertaining now. We laugh it off. Because we've done this enough to know what Satan's doing.
Amen.
The church, don't be the source. Don't get involved in that stuff. Because the Bible says God hates people that sow discord. That's not the church. I struggled with how to close this thing last week and even this week. But I think I want to do it like this. I'll ask our musicians just very quickly.